Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha.
So we are on the chapter 13 of Bhagavad Gita, and I guess we are meeting after a month or more, maybe 2 months. Alright. So just because we are coming close to the 18th chapter, before we proceed ahead, maybe we can just do some basic FAQs. So we know that all of you at least are aware that we are studying Bhagavad Gita. In case. So how many chapters does Bhagavad Gita has? How many verses? And what are the top prominent five subject matters of Bhagavad Gita? All right, okay, basic things. And similarly, accordingly, there are three sections of Bhagavad Gita, 18 chapters divided into three sections. The first six chapters form the basis of Karma Yoga, 7 to 12 is Bhakti Yoga, and 13 to 18 chapter is what known as Jnana Yoga. Jnana Yoga, after Bhakti Yoga, Bhakti is said to be the highest, then why discuss about Jnana Yoga? What is the need of it? It should be an obvious question, isn't it? Why talk about Jnana Yoga? See, generally the idea in this world is, in incremental fashion, when you're going up, either it is in ascending order or descending order, isn't it? So if first chapter, first six section, or the first six chapter represented Karma Yoga, higher than that was Bhakti Yoga. Now the last six chapters are Jnana Yoga. Does it mean Jnana Yoga is higher than Bhakti Yoga, or what's the idea about it? So why Krishna is speaking about Jnana Yoga? Jnana and then Vairagya. If we have knowledge, then only we can develop renunciation. So what we're going to study in the six chapters is Krishna have already discussed in brief. Now the details will be provided. So when we begin with it, I'll give you the just brief overview of the next six chapters in Jnana Yoga, and then we'll start with today's discussion. So knowledge is very important and is required so that we can extricate or cut off our attachment to this material life. And that's the reason Krishna begins to speak about Jnana Yoga. Now, you all remember, you all have studied this something called as yoga ladder. What does yoga ladder begins with? Yes? Yes, it begins with Karma Yoga, but prior to that comes Karma Kanda. It's not part of the yoga ladder, but that's a stepping stone. So what you said is correct in that sense. After Karma Kanda, or the stepping stone, is Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is divided into two parts, Sakama Karma Yoga and Nishkama Karma Yoga. After Karma Yoga, what does Krishna speaks about? Jnana Yoga, right? After Jnana Yoga, now this is yoga ladder, it's an incremental order. You are growing up and growing up. That's the whole idea. After Jnana Yoga comes Ashtanga Yoga. And after Ashtanga Yoga, you're at the top of the ladder, that's Bhakti Yoga. It's very important for us to get this understanding, so you will know why Krishna is speaking about this all different processes and different paths, the Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga and so forth. So what happens in Karma Kanda? At Karma Kanda, at this stage, we begin to practice religious life. You are told what to do, what not to do. Karma Kanda, to be practiced under rules and regulation. So at this stage, we do a regulated sense gratification. So you may ask, Prabhuji, what is before Karma Kanda? If you are doing a regulated sense gratification in Karma Kanda stage, so what would be before Karma Kanda? Animalistic life. Unrestricted. That's animalistic life, as we have been discussing in our Saturday evening program. So Karma Kanda, through that, so the practice of Karma Kanda, person develops regulated, engages in regulated sense gratification. And after repeated attempts of doing regulated sense gratification, over a period of time, he develops some sense or some idea of spirituality. Actually, this all doesn't give me happiness at the end of the day. After repeated attempts, I'm still frustrated. We were talking on Karma Kanda, which is a stage of regulated sense gratification. And after trying to gratify one's senses, being repetitively not being successful in it, that person looks towards the direction of spirituality. And that's the time he progresses towards the next stage called as Sakama Karma Yoga. It's a very important subject matter for us to understand because it'll tell us where we are right now, which path, on what step of spiritual life we are. Sakama Karma Yoga, which means at this stage, yoga means, whenever word yoga comes, it means connecting with the Lord. So through his work, he's trying to connect with the Lord, which is bona fide way of Karma Yoga. However, Sakama Karma Yoga means one is attached to the type of work and also to the fruits. Fruits means the result of his work. He is very much attached to that. However, he uses some of that result of his work in the service of the Lord. But he is very attached to it. That's Sakama Karma Yoga, because he has his own desires to be fulfilled. Once a person practices, you know, at this stage for a long, long time, then if he's successful, then he graduates. You know, these all are inherently itself purifying process. If you're living, there are also a lot of rules and regulation to abide by. We are just giving a high level definition. When you live by it, it is also self-purifying. So it's purifying your consciousness. And then a person comes to a stage called as Nishkam Karma Yoga. What is Nishkam Karma Yoga? At this stage, the person is still attached to the type of work, but now he has become detached to his results. Which means I will do this thing only, but I got nothing to do with the result. You keep all the result. For example, say he's serving in temple and he's managing, let's say, the food court in the temple. Let's say Govindas. I would put it other way around. So temple authorities ask, what would you like to do? You want to do some service in the temple? And he's given him 5 options. And he says, I would do only this particular service because I like food and all that. And he chooses that. And what about your sustenance? How much would you like us to give you in case, you know, you're a family man? For that, he says, whatever you want, you can give me. So detached. So he's earning on behalf of the temple. He's managing the food court, but he is not caught up with that idea. He said, no, fine. Whatever you want to give me, you give me. That is something like that to help you understand. That is Nishkama Karma Yoga. You see, something is happening as we're progressing. As we are progressing, we are becoming more detached. We are becoming more detached. At the stage of Nishkama Karma Yoga, or the culmination of Nishkama Karma Yoga, the person has become detached from the fruits. What happened when you become detached from the results of your work? Yes, all our anxiety is because of our too much attachment to the results of our work. Yes or no? What will happen to my position? What will happen to my wealth? What will happen to this and that? All anxiety is because of that. So at this stage, our mind has become calm and peaceful, but not purified. So in Nishkam Karma Yoga, by the practice of Nishkam Karma Yoga up to this stage, our senses have become purified because we are not engaging in any wrong thing. Whatever we are trying to do, with that we are trying to serve the Lord. That's a Nishkam Karma Yoga. And then maybe in some lifetime, this is not your 1 year course. 1 year you're in Karmakanda, second year, maybe I don't know what exam you can have, but second year you qualify. If you pass the exam, you go to Sakama Karma Yoga. These are lifetimes of effort. It's not that easy. And then you come to Jnana Yoga stage. At the Jnana Yoga stage, your mind is at peace. Jnana Yoga means you have to study. Swadhyaya, you have to leave everything. Now you have reached certain level of detachment by the end of Nishkam Karma Yoga, which means a person at this stage probably would not get into a family life for the first. In case if he is willing to go and leave everything, forego everything and go live in the forest. Like in chapter 6, Arjuna and Krishna is having a discussion and Krishna says this is not meant for this stage, for this particular age. So a person is willing to live in the forest, live as simple as possible, and he want to find out who is the absolute truth. Now at all these stages, the person does not know who is the Supreme Personality Godhead. Maybe, maybe not. He may know and he may not know. When a person is trying to make endeavor on his own by not having a bona fide guidance, this is what happens to his stages of progress. He comes to Jnana Yoga, and through Jnana Yoga means he's studying Shastras. Shastras are vast and he's trying to find out who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the object of my worship. By the practice of Jnana Yoga, by living a very simple and austere life in the forest, so you have got quite a good control on your mind and senses, at that stage you qualify to practice Ashtanga Yoga. So Ashtanga Yoga is practiced at a stage when you have quite good control on your mind and senses. Through the practice of Jnana Yoga, your mind becomes purified. And after that, you enter Ashtanga Yoga. Ashtanga Yoga has, Asht means eight limbs. Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, and Samadhi. And now this Ashtanga Yoga, now again, this is not a weekend program. Kardama Muni, one of the great progenitors, one of the great sages mentioned in the pages of Bhagavatam, he had to practice Ashtanga Yoga for 10,000 years. After that, he attained the perfection of Ashtanga Yoga. What is the perfection of Ashtanga Yoga? That he attained Samadhi. And what is the Samadhi? Now, he's able to hold the form of the Lord in his heart. And then finally, when Kadama Muni was able to do so, and then the Lord appeared in front of him in a personal form. Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagwan. Brahmeti, Paramateti, Bhagwan iti Shabdeti. And then he gets to a Bhagwan realization where he gets to see the personal form of the Lord. And when it happens, then he qualifies himself to a stage called as Bhakti Yoga, where now he knows the Lord is a person. And now I can personally serve him. And there is a reciprocation. So this is called as yoga ladder. And this is what has been described in Bhagavad Gita. Making sense? And at this stage, person engages in personal service of the Lord. And that is the whole idea of your Bhakti Yoga. Now $1 million question. Where are you on this yoga ladder? Let me tell you where you all are. You all are, including I, at the stage of Bhakti Yoga. Now, why we are at the stage of Bhakti Yoga? At least with this little description, all of us would agree that we don't have any qualification to be above Karmakanda. Yes or no? And that is what the glories of our acharyas, Srila Prabhupada, he gave us that qualification, and all the predecessors and all the current acharyas, they gave us that qualification to be situated on the platform of Bhakti Yoga. Now, how do I prove it? See, as I said, people are trying to walk up this ladder on their own endeavor. So all the while, they're trying to search who is the absolute. Getting the point? Just like Prabhupada was having this Pandal program in Bombay back in 1970s. And there was this five-year-old daughter of Mother Malati, Saraswati. And she would go and ask the audience, do you know who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead? And people would be clueless. And they said, no. And Saraswati would say, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Prabhupada said, this is Bhakti Yoga. It's so simple that even a five-year-old girl knows who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And here sages, yogis, for millions and millions of lifetimes, they spent all their life performing austerities and whatnot just to figure out who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So what was the qualification of Saraswati? That she had a teacher, she had an access to a teacher like Srila Prabhupada, who could directly tell her the culmination or the conclusion of this whole yoga ladder. Again, yoga means to connect. Yoga means to link. Link with whom? The Supreme Person. And all through this process, everyone is trying to figure it out, who is the Supreme Person. And there are many accidents that happen when you're trying to climb up the yoga ladder. Some people end up assuming actually that Supreme Person is none other than I only. Yeah, many people end up saying that I am God after a practice of yoga. You have seen many God and goddesses here in the India? Ek to Bombay mein rehti hai. There are many goddesses and goddesses in India. They practice all this thing and finally they come to conclusion, I am God. Or they do it, practice by themselves. Okay, don't get too much disturbed or who's that lady? If you're so curious, I'll let you know when post-recording. Huh? Everyone loves controversy, isn't it? Bechare jo so rahe the, unki neend kharab kar di hum logo ne. All right. What are we talking about? So some people end up thinking that I am God, you know, with their practice and so forth. Some people end up thinking, actually, God doesn't exist. God is not a person. God is an energy, is a light, what they call as Brahman. So they end up to different conclusions. But look, for us, without any of our, ask yourself, you don't have to tell me, but you can genuinely ask yourself, what amount of austerities, penances, or sacrifice any one of us have done here to receive the culmination of this yoga, the knowledge of yoga? I just give an example of Kardama Muni. He performed 10,000 years of severe penance and austerities, living in the forest all by himself. At that end of 10,000 years ago, he received that realization that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So what happens when we receive something too easily? We take it to be too cheaply. What we do? We take it to be too cheaply. And that's what happened. Prabhupada said, Krishna consciousness is so simple that you will simply miss it out. Krishna consciousness is so simple that you will simply miss it out. Because none of us have done that hard work to come to this understanding. We are not serious about it. And that's the overall picture of majority of the people in ISKCON at large. Because very easily we get a copy of Bhagavad Gita, any page you open, Prabhupada says, Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Oh, really? That's it. We get to know about it. Courses have been designed, curriculums have been there, where very systematically every questions get answered. And who is the Supreme Personality, which is a question to be answered after millions of lifetimes of penances and austerity. We get it into three, four weeks of interaction with ISKCON devotees, isn't it? Because we get the answer so easily, we often doesn't take it seriously. And that's the reason where you were saying, I'm in Karma Kanda, Sakam, Karma Yoga, because you have chosen to be there. You have been given access for Bhakti Yoga, but you have chosen to stay there only because you are not realizing what gift has been given to you. Imagine you give a beggar who doesn't know, or let not a beggar, imagine you give a very costly diamond to a child who doesn't know the value of it. And imagine he's playing a game where you have to put a, you know, sometimes they play a game where they put a stone to balance. He thinks the diamond is nothing but any other weight to, or any other way to balance it out. At times, this is what has happened to us. And that's the reason we are stuck at our different stages. Being stuck is not a problem, but being comfortable there is a problem. I hope I'm making sense. Being stuck is not a problem, but being comfortable there is a problem, and saying, that's what I am. Don't ask much from me. Don't ask me to move forward. This is what my position is. But for all of us, we have been given the highest in such an easiest manner. And what we have to do? The process is so simple, all of us know. Chant 16 rounds Hare Krishna Mahamantra, stay in the association devotees, eat Krishna Prasadam, read, do services, which is the foremost idea. Now, service is the only austerity for the current day. And of course, the chanting also. Everything has a certain amount of austerities. What's our level of sacrifice? If you do any seva, does it involve sacrifice? Yes or no? Yes. Every seva involves sacrifice. For example, mother taking care of a child. That's a seva done by a mother to a child. Is a sacrifice involved or not? And that amount of sacrifice that you're willing to do is equivalent or proportion to your love for the child, yes? Now, there could be a mother who may decide, enough of this child, I'll put her in a daycare or whatever we have. And her amount of sacrifices, I'll take the child to daycare and drop her. That's also a sacrifice just to take to daycare, but I'll drop her and let somebody else take care of the child. Whereas the other mother decides, no, I'm going to make sure that I breastfeed my child. I'm not going to give her the, what they call the milk powder and things. I'm going to make sure that I give my own milk to the child. I am by the side of my child all day. What do you see the difference would happen to the child who has grown up in a daycare drinking a bottled milk, and to a child who had drank mother's milk and have had mother by his or her side? What do you think would be a difference in both when they grow up? Well, let those who have got the parents answer first.
I'll come to bachelor's later on. Please forgive me, I don't mean that. But I mean to say, you may have more worldly experience as a different thing, but they have a practical knowledge of it. So let the parents think about it.
Jo bottle peeke bada hua hai, wo bottle peete peete hi jiyega. All right? Got it? Jo bottle peeke bada hua hai na, wo bottle peete peete hi jiyega. और एंड में हॉस्पिटल में भी बोतल के संग ही पड़ा रहेगा. समझ गए ना परपर तो नहीं देना ना ऑल राइट इंटेलिजेंट ना गुड नाउ हु हैज गॉट मदर्स लव सी व्हाट इज द मिल्क दैट्स अ ब्लड ट्रांसफॉर्म्ड इनटू अ मिल्क आई बिलीव ऑल ऑफ अस वुड बी अवेयर ऑफ इट एंड व्हाट ट्रांसफॉर्म द मिल्क टू ब्लड टू अ मिल्क दैट्स द अफेक्शन ऑफ द मदर When the mother is feeding her milk to the child, is actually she is investing her love into the child. And of course, the child would grow up to be an entirely different person, would have a strong bonding with the mother. Why? Because mother have sacrificed her blood for the child. And so the child is going to have that strong connection with the mother. The point I'm trying to bring, unless we sacrifice, what is the question of reciprocation? Unless we learn to sacrifice, Where is the question of reciprocation? जिसने बॉटल मिल्क लिया है वो क्या रेसिप्रोकेट करेगा क्योंकि उसको कभी माँ ध्यान नहीं आएगी उसको सिर्फ बॉटल याद आएगी बिकॉज यू हैव ऑलवेज सीन बॉटल नेक्स्ट टू हिम नॉट द मदर एंड इन दैट सिचुएशन वी एक्सपेक्ट रेसिप्रोकेशन क्यों नहीं है भगवान का रेसिप्रोकेशन क्यों नहीं है भक्तों का रेसिप्रोकेशन नहीं है देन इट्स अ क्वेश्चन फॉर अस टू आस्क वॉट हैव आई सेक्रीफाइस वॉट एम आई विलिंग टू सेक्रीफाइस दैट्स अ सिंपल थिंग एंड वी आर देयर वी ऑलरेडी हैव द हाइएस्ट It is who you and I have chosen not to receive the highest or maintain the highest. We are trying to settle in for something low, fine, but don't feel comfortable there. Or else you'll miss the whole journey. If we don't make our life successful in this attempt that we have in the Sangha, we don't know what will happen to the next destination, where we would be. And something for each one of us to think about. It's a very serious subject matter. Because all of us, by will of providence or by a coincidence, have got access to this great knowledge, have got access to this great Vaishnava Sangha. But what guarantee is there that will be available next time? What guarantee is there? And that is something which we should be coming to an understanding when we are about to begin chapter 13 of Bhagavad Gita. We have read 12 chapters. And that's where the chapter 13 begins with the idea of Jnana Yoga. Jnana or Jnana se aata hai vairagya. So, I already said why discuss Jnana Yoga as Jnana gives vairagya. So, whatever subject matter Krishna have discussed, chapter 2 is a summary of whole Bhagavad Gita. And rest of the chapters are elaboration, particularly up to 17th chapter. 18th chapter is a conclusion. So, in this particular chapter, you will have discussion on 6 questions asked by Arjuna in the set of 3. The first set is Purusha and Prakriti. He asks Krishna, My dear Lord, who is this Purusha and who is this Prakriti? Second set of question is, what is Kshetra and Kshetrajna? What is Kshetra and Kshetrajna? Kshetra means field of activity and Kshetrajna, Jna means knowledge. Who is the knower of the field of activity? And the third set of question is Jnanam and Jnayam. Jnanam means what is the process of knowledge and Jnayam means what is the object of knowledge. And these 6 questions are the major subject matter of your Upanishads. The vast Vedic scriptures that we call as Upanishads and other under its umbrella, all that Vedic scriptures, 108 Upanishads and whatnot we have, the whole subject matter of that is this 6 prominent questions. So chapter 13th is the most complicated chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Yet is the most important chapter. Well, I should not say yet is the most important because every chapter of Bhagavad Gita is important. But what in context I'm saying is the most important means whatever this Upanishad, after reading 108 Upanishads, vast literatures, what answers you will get, Krishna have given you in less than 35 verses. Krishna has given you all that wisdom in less than 35. So if you read this chapter, you have learned all the Upanishads. Because these are the 6 prominent questions of Upanishad. What are the 6 prominent questions? Purusha Prakriti, Kshetra Kshetrajna, Jnanam and Jnayam. Process of knowledge and object of knowledge. So here, I'll just give you a quick 2-2 line overview of the 6 chapters of this Jnana Yoga. I just described to you what is chapter 13th. After chapter 13 comes chapter 14, which is titled as 3 modes of material nature. And Krishna has a nice laughter when he begins his chapter. He's cracking up. Why is he cracking up? Krishna is saying everyone thinks, I am the doer, I am the controller. And then Krishna says, Arjuna, let me tell you a confidential knowledge. Arjuna says, My dear Lord, what it is? Arjuna, people think they are the controller and they are the doer, but the fact is they are nothing more than a puppet. They're nothing more than the puppet. You know, puppet show? There is a puppeteer, has the strings, and is pulling the string, and the puppet is dancing to the strings of the puppeteer. Krishna says, similarly is the life of each one of us. All of our actions, all of our thoughts, how we act, how we think, what we like, what we dislike, everything is governed by a very important subject matter which is discussed here, is by the modes of material nature. Each one of us are affected by a mode of goodness, passion, and ignorance. If something is prominent, let's say mode of passion, accordingly we have our eating habits. Accordingly, we have our sleeping habits, working habits, walking habits, whatnot. Accordingly, we speak. It's all affected by the modes. And Krishna says, yet the puppet thinks he is the puppeteer. And that's the reason Krishna has a great nice laughter in the session. And then Krishna comes to the 15th chapter, titled as the Yoga of the Supreme Person. Krishna says, people are so much in ignorance. First, they think they are the controller. Second, they think they are the proprietor. They think this belongs to them. This is their property. This is their possession. Imagine you check in into a hotel room. You get inside the hotel room and you begin to renovate that hotel room. You take out all the tiles thinking that I would like to have this hotel room like I want it. You take out all the paintings and all what you have on the hotel room, and you try to set it up according to your interest. Would anyone call this person a crazy person or not? It's a hotel room. It's a temporary place. This is not your permanent place. And Krishna says like that, we are trying to find permanent happiness in a temporary place. We are trying to find a permanent, or we are trying to create a permanent comfortable situation of our life in this temporary place. And through this chapter, Krishna introduces the subject matter once again about the spiritual world, and he tries to attract our attention to our original home, that is spiritual world or adhyatmik dunya. There was a man who went to visit a sage. He was told that at such and such place, that's the house of the sage, go and meet him. When this man entered the house of the sage, he was shocked, because in that house there was nothing except for the sage and the mat on which the sage was sitting. And immediately this man asked, where are all your possessions? Where are all your belongings? Isn't this your house? And the sage looked at this man and said, where are all your belongings? And the man said, well, this is not my house. And the sage said, well, this isn't my house either. I'm just temporarily living in this house, which means the world. That's the whole idea. And through this chapter, Krishna brings out that knowledge through the discussion on that. The next chapter is chapter number 16, the divine and the demoniac. In this world, always there are two kinds of people. One is divine and demoniac. And Krishna speaks about the qualities and the characteristics of both the divine and demoniac. Simultaneously, he also exposes the attitudes and behaviors that are detrimental or harmful for one's journey in the spiritual life. The attitudes and behavior that are detrimental for one's progress in spiritual life are also discussed in this particular chapter, the divine and demoniac. This is all under Jnana Yoga. This, you know, the concluding chapters. Then it comes to the divisions of faith, chapter number 17. If you all see, life is not, you can say, like a black and white. You cannot say one person is divine, another person is demoniac. All of our life experiences teaches us that we have different faces, which means at different times we exhibit sometimes divine propensities, sometimes demonic propensities. Yes, we all have that experience. And that is what Krishna brings out the subject matter here, that faith, the faith that we carry, is also influenced by the modes. If the mode of ignorance is prominent in you, you will have a certain kind of faith at a given point of time. If mode of passion becomes prominent in you, then you will have a certain kind of faith at a given point of time. Have you seen people? They act at a given point of time in a different manner. And suddenly in a different situation, a different time, they act entirely opposite to it. Yes or no? And when they act opposite in that way, they are very convinced what they are doing. And that is what the subject matter. The faith is also affected, influenced by the modes you are. A very important discussion here. And then comes the concluding chapter, the perfection of renunciation. Chapter 18 is a conclusion of whole Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna, through the message of Bhagavad Gita, brings out the message that an opportunity of permanent happiness and fulfillment is given to everyone through the achievement of Krishna consciousness. One who is practicing Krishna consciousness, he has an opportunity to access permanent happiness and fulfillment of life. And that achievement of Krishna consciousness is said to be the perfection of renunciation. What is the perfection of renunciation? When a person develops or comes to a stage of full Krishna consciousness. And what is the consequence of this stage? Or what is the symptom of this stage of perfect renunciation or full Krishna consciousness? In that stage, Brahma Bhuta Prasanatma Na Suchati Na Kangshati. Which means at this stage, a person can smile in any situations or among any challenges, because he knows that the smiling Krishna is always by his side. So he does not have to fear anything. And that is where chapter 18 ends, with this prominent message. So what is perfection of renunciation? Achievement of Krishna consciousness. That qualifies you to be happy regardless of any situation and circumstances, because that time we have got the strong faith based on knowledge that this beautiful Krishna is always by my side to protect me. And that is what the culmination of Bhagavad Gita. With that, we'll begin today's discussion. I mean, I had to warm up you, right? We are meeting after several months. So I had to just wake you up. Hello, this is Bhagavad Gita, not Mahabharata, the discussion. Huh? So now you at least recall that once upon a time you were studying Bhagavad Gita. So let's take a look at the acronym for this chapter. The acronym for this chapter is WISE, where W stands for wise questions, from verse number 1 to 7. I stands for items of knowledge, verse number 8 to 12. S for soul and super soul, verse number 13 to 19. And the last, E for enjoyer, verse number 20 to 35. Before I enter into this chapter, any clarification from the discussion that we had? I can only pray that I hope I made some sense. You got something out of it, all right. So let's begin with it. The wise questions. I've already said what questions Arjuna asked. Arjuna had asked 6 questions. Prakriti, Purush, Kshetra, Kshetrajna, Jnanam, and Jnayam. So I'll quickly give you an overview of these questions. So Kshetra and Kshetrajna. This is also a very controversial chapter of Bhagavad Gita. I'll keep some controversies for the next weekend. So I already touched upon one controversy. So about this, I'll speak next weekend. But it's a very controversial chapter. We'll talk about that next time. In case if I forget, you remind me, Prabhuji, some controversial subject matter is pending from last time. So, Kshetra and Kshetrajna. This is the very first verse of Bhagavad Gita, or the 13th chapter. So Kshetra refers to field of activity, and Kshetrajna is knower. Let me give you an example. You have an agricultural land where a farmer works. He would put a seed into it, he will till the ground, he'll water the seed, and over a period of time the seed would fructify into a plant and a tree, and you'll get fruits, flowers, whatnot. So for a farmer, what is the field of activity? The agricultural land. And for the agriculture land, who is the knower of that field of activity? The farmer. Is that clear? Now, what is this field of activity refers to? The field of activity for us, that agriculture land, is nothing other than our own body. In this body, the knower of the body, which is Kshetagya, which refers to Atma, he sows the seed of karma. And by his activity, how he waters or nourishes that seed of karma, we get good results and bad results. That is Kshetra. This is the field of activity. We are trying to fulfill the needs and requirements of this field of activity, right? And through that, we are trying to interact with the rest of the creation. Now, a farmer knows only about his field, right? His knowledge is limited only to his field of activity. He doesn't know about all the lands. But one person knows about all the land. Who is that? The government. The government has an idea of all the land. Similarly, in this body, there is not only soul residing. Along with the soul, there is also super soul, Paramatma. The difference between Paramatma and Atma is that Atma is only aware of the body. Atma is only aware of the body, whereas Paramatma is aware of all the bodies. So he is said to be a supreme Kshetrajna. And we are known as to be a minute Kshetrajna because I only know that to a limited extent about this field of activity. And then moving forward in this set of verses, what is this field of activity? There are five questions which are touched upon. Please read 13.5 verse, 13 chapter 5th verse, where five very analytical subject matter are touched upon, which are discussed in the rest of the chapter. Like, what are the constituents of the body? How the body is created? Like that. Can anyone read out? Excuse me. Can anyone read out the question, the verse 13.5 loudly? Yeah, translation.
That knowledge of the field of activity, not the knower of activity, is described by various stages in various Vedic writings. It is especially presented in Vedic.
No, 13.4, a verse prior to it.
13.4. Now please hear a brief description of this field of activity and how it is constituted.
Yes. Now start paying attention. There are five questions being addressed in this, which would be answered. And that is why it is an analytical chapter. What is the first point?
What its changes are?
No, what is the first point?
Description of the field of activity.
Yeah, description of. Okay, I'll open it. I'll read it out. So 5 points, very important question. What is the description of this field of activity, which means the body? Field of activity is the body. What is the description of this body? How it is constituted, which means how is it made? What are the building blocks of this body? What its changes are? The third question. Fourth, when it is produced? What is the origin of this body? And the fifth, who that knower of the field of activities and what his influences are together? These are the five prominent questions like that. So what are the constituents of the body is being mentioned in verse number 6-7. I will not go much in details, but I'll tell you, this is what is the basis of Sankhya Yoga. Our this whole body is made up of 24 elements. Some other time in future, when we have detailed discussion, I'll give you a whole understanding of it. But I'll give you in 5 minutes, what are these? Now there are five, which is called as Bhuta or Panch Bhutas, five gross element. What are they? Earth, water, fire, air, ether. So do you all agree we have this with us? These five elements? That's the top row. Then we have five Jnana Indriya. What are the Jnana Indriya? Ears, eyes, nose, tongue, and sense of touch. That's the second row. Then we have Karma Indriya, working senses, that we have a voice, the hands, the legs, the feet, or the hands, the voice, the feet, and the genital and the anus. These are the five working senses. So how many elements today together now? 5 + 5 + 5 = 15. Then we have five objects of the senses with which we gratify. For the eye, there has to be a form. For ear, there has to be sound. For tongue, there has to be a taste. And for nose, there has to be a smell. And for touch, there has to be an object of touch. So these are five, the forms of the object or the object of the senses. How many covers now? 20. remaining four. What are the other four elements? One is man, that is mind, intelligence, and false ego. How many together? Do we all agree this is there with universally every living entity? This is not only a human's proprietary. This is for all living entities. Yes, we have that. And the 24th element is Pradhan, which is a building block. A detailed description of that is given in second canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And these are the constituents of a body. Incredible science. Not just like what they talk about chemical composition. Okay. Now, we wish to come to a very important subject matter, which I thought we'll spend the most of the time, but introduction went a little longer. Now, a question. I would say again a million-dollar question. ये सब समझ आए तो कैसे? सुनने में अच्छा तो बहुत लगता है. But समझ क्यों नहीं आता? How can I understand the science of Bhagavad Gita? How do you think you can understand? What do you think about it? How can I understand the science of Bhagavad Gita? Now, all of you, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. You all know, or personally would recognize your level of understanding of the science. And if you look around here, some of you have been coming from the beginning when we started our initial programs here. Even among those crowds, and the crowd which has come maybe in the last 1 or 2 years, those who came later, you may find some people who have far, far better understanding than you, although you have been coming for the last 4 or 5 years. There could be a possibility of it. What makes the other person understand far much more easily than I? Why I'm not able to understand? That question is also addressed here in the verses 8 to 12. So when you study Bhagavad Gita or any spiritual text, first thing that we need to be very clear about it, it is not a question, subject matter of one's caliber. It's not a subject matter of one's erudition or intelligence. If you're a topper in a class, it doesn't mean the topper in the class has a far more easy access to Bhagavad Gita than who somebody who flunked or failed in the class. Not at all. If you have to understand Bhagavad Gita, we can only understand Bhagavad Gita if we give focus on the character. So I'm putting up two things together, caliber versus character. Bhagavad Gita or science or spirituality cannot be understood by one's own caliber. What matters most is the character. Are we building up? Are we focusing on improving ourselves, our qualities, our attributes? And that is a subject matter. The more we do so, the more easily we'll be able to understand the science of Bhagavad Gita. And that is what Krishna is speaking about in verses 8 to 12. Krishna says to Arjuna, hey Arjuna, what I'm about to tell you is 20 items of knowledge. And there are two things about this 20 items of knowledge. The more you practice these items, the more you qualify yourself to spiritual life, or more easily you have access to Krishna consciousness. That's one side of the equation. Other side of the equation is, the more you sincerely endeavor to practice Krishna consciousness, simultaneously you will develop rest of the qualities. Is it confusing? The more you try to cultivate these qualities, practice of Krishna consciousness becomes easy. The more sincerely you practice Krishna consciousness, you simultaneously cultivate these qualities. Yasyasti bhaktir bhagvati yakinchana sarve gunestatra samasata suraha hara bhaktasya kuto mahadguna manorathe nasti dhavato bahi. Yasyasti bhaktir bhagvati yakinchana, one who is engaged in rendering devotional service, unalloyed devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Yasyasti bhaktir bhagvati akinchana sarver gunes tatra samasate suraha. Jitne bhi devtaon ke acche gun hote hain, wo us vyakti ke andar apne aap ubhar kar aane lagte hain. Example, Mrigari the hunter. Now you all have heard the story of Mrigari the hunter. He was such a violent person, he would not kill the animal fully. He would half kill. He was a hunter, so that's how he would make his living. But he would enjoy, his happiness lies in seeing the animals suffering and struggling to death. And when Narad Muni came by there, he told him, if you have to, you know, first of all, why do you do this? The Magari said, well, what else can I do for my living? This is what my parents taught me, and this is how I maintain my family. The Narad Muni said, well, at least you kill them fully. Why do you pierce them with your arrow half and leave them on the ground to bitterly suffer and die? Why are you torturing? So he said, well, I can do that much. And then Narad Muni discussed and told him further, do you know what is the result of this activity that you do? And he explained him the law of karma and so forth. Long story short, Mrigari understood what he is doing is wrong. He should not do it. But he was such a sinful person that he couldn't chant the names of the Lord. So Narad Muni told him, chant Mara Mara Mara. As you all know, gradually he came to chant Ram Ram Ram. Mara 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 Ram Ram Ram. That's how he went to chanting the Ram. He was so sinful that he could not even utter the name of Lord Ram. Do you think this is only in the bygone ages? I knew a person. He was, I believe, from Ukraine. This is back, and I don't want to name the place and city where I met him. He told me, Prabhu, when I came to, in the beginning days, this is more than 20 years ago now, in fact, this is more than 30 years ago when he came to bhakti. He said, when I came to Krishna consciousness, I could not even pronounce neither Hare nor Krishna or Rama. The words would not come out of my mouth only. I could not. I could read the Sanskrit shloka, but these will not come out of my mouth. And then when I studied more and later on, I realized because of my such a sinful background, the Lord would not allow me to utter his name. So Mrigari was so sinful, he could not even utter the name of Lord Ram. But because he followed the instructions of Narad Muni, when Narad Muni, after some time back, came to meet Mrigari the hunter, look at the transformation. When he saw his spiritual master coming, he immediately excitingly got up and he wanted to run and fell at the feet of Narad Muni. But when he was running, suddenly he stopped and he fell on the ground and started to brush the ground. In the meantime, Narad Muni came at that point and he looked, and Narad Muni was surprised what his disciple was doing. His disciple was brushing off the ants which were crossing the way where he was running. So this hunter Mrigari, who used to half kill the animal, now today doesn't even want to step on the ants. Yasyasti bhaktir bhagvati akinchana sarve gunestatra samasate suraha. By the practice of devotional service, all the good qualities develop. And by making an endeavor to develop good qualities, your bhakti becomes easy. Now, there are hundreds of examples like that. We know of the prostitute who came to disrobe Haridas Thakur of his reputation. And that prostitute came so that Haridas Thakur can fall down and his good name and fame can be spoiled. What happened at the end of three nights? The prostitute began to chant the holy names of the Lord. And she accepted Haridas Thakur to be his spiritual master. And she went on to become such a sage, a prostitute. She was such a sinful lady. Her business was to spoil the character of good men. She went on to become such a sage that people would come and touch her feet. She went on to become such a saintly person just because she did two things. She accepted a teacher and she sincerely practiced the instruction of the teacher. Same is the case of Jagai Madhai. When they decided to surrender to Nityananda Prabhu and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, now Jagai Madhai were, Radhanath Maha says, were the biggest terrorists that this world has ever seen. There's not even a single sin or crime that Jagai Madhai would not have done it. They were so sinful. But the moment, you know, they will, just for fun, they'll kill people. Just for fun, they'll destroy the lives. They'll burn the property. They'll kidnap the girl. They'll do everything just for fun and adventure. They were so sinful. But when they surrendered to Nityananda Prabhu and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, just in a short while, they transformed so much. They stopped all their abominable activities. What was a cruel-hearted person, they transformed into such a soft-hearted person. Now, people knew that now these people do not take a revenge. But because people had a lot of anger, because many had lost their families, they had killed their families. So out of their rage, they'll take a stone and throw at Jagai and Madhai. And what they will do? When they'll be hit by that stone, when the blood would be profusely coming out of their body, they'll take the stone and bring it back to that person and tell them, please hit us again. We deserve more beating. We are so sinful. Now you may say, Prabhuji, this is 500 years ago. Does it really happen? Prabhupada started his mission with such kind of jagai madais only. What were the people of 1960s, 65? They were all engaged in all abominable activities. Just with a small, short duration of association of Srila Prabhupada, they gave everything. And matter of fact is, if all of us look back in our own life, and when we'll do this exercise, you'll realize what you were in the past and what you are in the present is a great difference. That should give you faith in the words of Krishna that Krishna says here. If among the 20 items, if somebody takes to one action item most prominently, that is to my devotional service, if one takes to that item sincerely, then all these action items would automatically develop. And what is that action item to take devotional service sincerely? How can I take devotional service sincerely? What is the requirement for that? You can only take devotional service seriously when we take shelter of Guru. How without a shelter of a teacher or a guru can we practice devotional life seriously? Somebody has to attest, right? You're doing right or wrong, isn't it? Or are we only going to evaluate ourselves that I'm doing right or wrong? So the two prominent things which are in this verse is, one is to render devotional service, and second is acharya pashanam, taking shelter of a spiritual master. Once we do these two things, then everything else develops. And that's the whole idea of this. So once we develop these qualities and practice of Krishna consciousness naturally becomes very easy, and it's a smooth journey. So given with that, I'll just read out this 20 action items. First is humility, pridelessness, non-violence, tolerance, simplicity, acharya upashanam, sixth, accepting a spiritual master, seventh, cleanliness, eighth, steadiness, 9, self-control, atma vinigraha, 10th, renunciation of sense objects, 11, absence of false ego, anhankarha, perceptions of janma mrityu jara vyadhi, 13th, detachment, 14th, non-entanglement. I have written in short, the description is given in the translation, we'll see that in a short while, 15th, even-mindedness, 16th, ananya bhakti, 17th, aspiring to live in a solitary place. Aspiring to live in a solitary place means to live only with devotees. That's the idea. 18th, detachment from the general mass of worldly-minded people. And 19th is accepting the importance of self-realization. And 20th, the search of absolute truth. What's the exercise all about? You're going to open 13.8 to 12 purport. Pair up with the devotee sitting next to you. Read the purport. When you read the purport, we have given you an empty space here. When you read the purport, you will get the exact definitions for each of these words. What does humility means? I didn't want it to spoon feed and give you the answer as it is, then you will not be able to use your brain and intelligence for a while. So read, because once you go through that purport, you will have to churn it 2-3 times to really get the meaning of every of those things. Write down those meanings, what Prabhupada have exactly said in a short form for this 20 items. Once you do for this 20 action items, I have made a last column, rate yourself. As we are talking about, the Krishna says, once you practice bhakti, you naturally develop these qualities. We quoted that verse, yasyasi bhaktir bhagavati akinchina. So Prabhupada in the purport says, purport writes that if you want to test yourself, how you are progressing in Krishna consciousness, these are the 20 items of knowledge on which you want to evaluate your progress. Which means many times devotees would ask, am I progressing or not? Well, if you're progressing or not, you give yourself ratings on these 20 items. So, for example, 0, which would mean, let's say, humility. The scale of rating is 0 to 10. 0 means non-existent. It does not exist. And 10 means, I will even beat Haridas Thakur in competition. That is 10. You know, even Haridas Thakur would fail in front of me. That's level 10. And 5 is an average. So, generally, I'll tell you what happens when people do exercises like this. By default, for everything they say, neither too good, not too bad. 5, 5, 5, 5, 5. Please don't do that, because I'm not going to ask you for the result. This is your self-analysis. So before you do rating, you have to really get the meanings of each word. The reason I asked you to do this, you do it, and then we can have a discussion if anyone has a clarification on any of the terminology. Once you're very clear, only on the meaning how Prabhupada have defined in the purport, you have to rate yourself. Because humility can be defined in many different ways. So way the Prabhupada have defined it, only in that context, try to rate yourself. And then you will know how you're doing. And if you're more adventurous, then you can add one more column to it, which I didn't do it. And the column that you can add is, right now you're rating yourself in the present situation, right? The next column could be, what was my level of this quality before I started practicing spiritual life? And if you see a positive change, yasyasti bhaktir bhagavati akinchana sarve gunestatra samasate sura, which means it's working. But don't be satisfied, huh? There are a lot more to go. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki, Bhagavad Gita ki,